Good evening, everybody, and I hope you don't think you're watching a an old screening of the select board, because there's only three of us here, but we're going to start with just three tonight. Ms. Chungala is at her brother's funeral in Spokane, Washington, and we wish her well and hope she has everything goes okay for her there. And then Ms. Keegan will be joining us a little later. She has an event she's at. So we have a little agenda, not that full, but it's going to take a bit. So first thing, it's 7 o'clock, and we have time set aside for public comment. Does anybody have it's just public comment. If you want to make a comment to us, we're not going to really answer you. If we need to schedule you for a meeting, we'll schedule you for a meeting and take it up again, but.
Well, several of us are here from Holly Road, but.
You're on the agenda.
But we're on the agenda,
yes.
So we will wait till then.
Okay.
It's been 3 weeks and we still don't have a clock in here yet. Mr. Chairman.
I know, it drives me crazy. I might make the meeting faster. All right, so we'll start off with the consent agenda. We have minutes from September 16th on the agenda on that. The warrants 16, 16S, 16A, 14W, 14Z, 25, 27, and 29. The IT contract for Northeast IT for the IT project, a one-day special wine and malt license for Kestrel Farm 5K. We have a pay rec number 13 and 14 for Schultz, M.W. Schultz. And we have the new Historic Commission member appointment for Catherine Kentfield.
So moved.
No.
May
what
I?
Would you like?
Take the Schmitz out of that and I'll be able to.
Schultz,
I'm sorry.
And for the record, that we're also placed on the consent agenda the new systems associates for the Dort contract for Town Hall.
They're on the same line as IT. Okay.
Yep.
So all those in favor of those items minus.
Is there a second?
Schultz? Yes.
Seconded.
Aye.
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 Okay.
We'll leave Schultz for later so Molly can vote on it.
Wow. 7:03, we still have some time for our first meeting.
One day liquor license, Ms. Hampshire Mall. Chairman?
We can do that. Go ahead. Mr. Nixon, the liquor license?
Oh. I can do it. The Pyramid Mall of Hadley, the Hampshire Mall, requested only on Monday a one-day liquor license for October 14th, 2015 for hosting the After 5 event on behalf of the Amherst Area Chamber of Commerce. The Chief of Police and the Fire Chief are in contact with her, and it will be it will have to be cordoned off in a certain area for them to hold it. So I would say there's no issues pending. They follow the guidelines set by the two police or the police and fire chief.
So the recommendation is to grant the one-day liquor license for this event, subject to any order of conditions imposed by the fire chief and the chief of police.
So moved.
All right, I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
It's all alcohol, too. Huh?
Yeah.
It's right at the Arizona Pizza. You know that, right? Okay.
So why don't we take up the Sealer of Weights and Measures contract with Northampton? So we've been going back and forth about this and back and forth about this, and the issue is indemnification. And our attorney says not to sign it because of indemnification. Northampton and Amherst did sign it.
As did Granby.
And Granby. And both their counsels said don't sign it because of indemnification. What it comes down to is we can't indemnify each other. So if we actually get in trouble, we can't indemnify them and they can't indemnify us because the law doesn't let us do that to each other. So the question then is, do we feel comfortable signing it even though it says that in the contract, or do we want to not sign it and try to go with the state?
What other options do we have with the state?
With the state that we would have to enter into a payment agreement with the state of Massachusetts, Commonwealth of Massachusetts, for the seal of weights and measures. It would be considerably more than what we are going to be paying to the city of Northampton, which would be about $17,000. So given that we've set this up in a revolving fund, which would be a self-sustaining revolving fund with no impact upon taxes or your budget, with Northampton in mind, and given that our council said that it's not a very good indemnification clause, but it's not prohibitively horrible, I think that our best bet for right now, given that we're not providing the service at all since the retirement of the state sealer of weights and measure fellow, that we go ahead and do this.
I thought Northampton was doing it originally, up until the first of the year only?
No, they're not doing it for us.
They weren't. We were still looking at it. We never made an agreement with them.
Yeah.
Someone was doing it.
That was Mr. Cybele with the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, okay. Division of Standards, and he's taken that early retirement.
Yeah, I kind of wish that would have been nice.
I'd like to see something from the state. I don't know what they plan on doing with this. Myself.
So you'd like to see how much it would, what they would do and how much they would charge, cost, and then we can compare the two?
Yeah.
Could it not be an immediate pass-through from the state, whatever the state number was?
I mean, obviously, Northampton's going to make a couple bucks on it.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about that.
As would we. You know, it's set up in order for us to get a little bit of administrative fees back. I don't know. We're not providing the service. We can do this as a stopgap and see how it goes. I'm happy to work with the state to come up with a formal agreement if you'd like that.
Well, I'd just like to see what it's going to cost. You know, these budgets are very, very tight.
Although the way we got it set up,
and we haven't done anything in the last 2 years I've been here, really.
But the way we have this one set up is the fees pay for the...
I know. I understand that.
We do have some places waiting for them to be... Stop and Shop had called the Department of Pharmacy there off, and they got cited because they didn't have an inspection. So we're kind of, you know, they're kind of waiting for us to...
I mean, the state don't have an assistant inspector or anybody to fill his shoes whatsoever. That's pretty hard to believe.
Yeah, they're not placing probably anybody to retire.
We can defer this for one more week and see what we can do about finding numbers from the state.
Okay. This is a month. This can't be month by month for. A temporary month by month while this is going on to buy a month here?
No, they're not interested in doing that.
No, they wanted a yearly contract, right?
Well this would be a 9 month, 8 month contract.
Nine month agreement.
Yeah. So why don't we ask real quick for the state if they can ask, give us that number for what it would take for next meeting and then we'll know.
Okay.
All right. I leaped up with my clock.
10 after.
Okay. Do we want to take up the administrator's goals and objectives? We've reviewed it. We're supposed to have the final document tonight.
Right. Molly and I are still working on that, so she said she's comfortable in deferring that for 1 week.
Okay.
Accountant's contract going to take long?
Yep, I don't think it will. So,
do business three.
Number three, accountant contract. So, if everybody hasn't heard, Gail, our accountant, is resigned and she's going to Orange.
Correct.
To be their accountant. It actually helps her retirement because she worked part-time in another community by combining them. So she's moving on. And our choices for replacing right now?
We have two choices. We've been exploring an outside vendor through the first one was referred to us by the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. It's an outfit out of Maynard called Bay State Municipal Accounting Group Incorporated, and they've submitted a proposal which is in front of you for $40,000 from October 1st prorated from October 13th, that would be $38,000, which happens to be the amount left over in the accountant's account. So, you know, that makes it very attractive. We've talked to these folks. They're willing to sign our agreement, which provides us with a lot of protection. They are very well recommended. They provide services to towns throughout Western Massachusetts. I think the closest one would be Coleraine. The second option would be to work with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission for a regional accounting service through which would be provided by an outfit called Eric Kinscherf Incorporated out of Sagamore Beach. Mr. Kinscherf interviewed very well. He's proposing to do it for $40,000 for the remainder of the year, and Pioneer Valley Planning Commission would assess an additional charge of $3,000. So we have one outfit that can do it for $38,000, another outfit that can do it for $43,000.
Check the references on both, David?
Yeah, excellent references on both. I recommend that we go with the Bay State Municipal Accounting Group as the lowest provider that's qualified to provide these services. This is exempt from bidding, by the way.
Any other questions?
No, that's it. Looks good.
Is there a motion?
Motion to recommend Bay State Municipal Accounting Firm finish out the term of the accounting for the next through
budgeted,
fiscal year.
And that's budgeted for the next 2 years anyway, right? If we need to go that far.
Yeah, so you have an option. You have 1 year to decide whether you want to go this way. Then there's an option to extend it for another 2 years, and the prices are there. So I've built that into a contract that it's our decision solely as to whether we go beyond it.
Yeah. That's 1 year through the term of the end of the fiscal year.
Correct.
Fiscal year.
Okay.
June 30th, it looks like. That's the way it's here, right?
Right. So I think the board wanted to use this as an opportunity to assess the municipal accounting here in Town Hall. This would be give us an opportunity to do so.
Motion on the floor, Chair.
Is there a second? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
7:14, Chairman.
All right. So it's pretty close to 7:15, which is our first appointment. And our first appointment tonight is the Pride Station. So we need to reopen the liquor license hearing from August 12th. Is there a motion to do that?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. This is really strange, only having the three of us here.
I guess just for a procedural matter, I'm Attorney James Channing, representing Pride. Before I want to reopen the hearing, I just want to obviously address our precarious situation that we only have three members here of the five. So technically we have a quorum. I guess our concern is that anything we may do or say with respect to the application could be considered reopening the hearing and waiving those two individuals to potentially vote in a future. If a vote would not be taken today in the future, so I defer to maybe the administrator, or at least ask for a break or time to discuss as to whether or not in fact that would be the case. I don't want to forfeit those two individuals' right to vote or participate in future deliberations.
In that we're being videotaped, the planning board allows the review of the tape to be utilized. We have another member that will be here in approximately 15 minutes, so we'll only be short one member, and Ms. Chungalo is at a funeral for her brother in Spokane, Washington.
Yeah,
so, okay.
We're not taking exception to that, but we just like to address procedurally as to.
That's what we have available to you. If that works, if it doesn't work, up to you.
And then do we understand that because it's being recorded, if you choose not to vote tonight anyway, the fifth person, when she returns, could still vote?
She'll be able to review the videotape and then vote in the future.
Unless right now we've got a quorum and all three of us vote yay or nay, then it doesn't matter at that point.
Correct.
That's true. That's the dice we throw.
Yeah, but we've kind of already opened the hearing here, so I mean, unless you want us to not open the hearing, but if we don't continue the hearing today, we also run into the issue of,
could we just suggest we wait for 15 minutes?
We can. So is that all right with the board?
It's fine with me.
We'll recess the hearing until, all right?
Thank you.
And our 7:35 meeting is not coming tonight.
They're not coming tonight.
So just for those who are paying attention, our 7:35 appointment was the Hemden Care Facility to talk about a medical marijuana dispensary. So if you're really waiting for that, they're not coming, seemingly. Which you can stay if you want to. All right. So we'll move on to the layout of Laurel Drive and Holly Road, town ways.
So this is a legal procedure to gets us one step further, closer to having a town meeting vote. There is a site visit planned for tomorrow at 4:30 at Laurel Drive, and then at 5:00 at Holly Road. And at least one select board member should attend, view those two roads, and then you have a formal vote to actually lay out the roads as required by law at your meeting of October 14th, which still gives us enough time to get this voted by town meeting if everything works correctly.
Okay, so Mr. Vine, are you available?
I'm available, but I believe it's a conflict.
Okay.
To make any decisions on those two roads on behalf of the DPW.
Has Ms. Keegan informed you if she can make it or not?
She hasn't, so let's find out when she arrives whether she's available.
All right. Well, she's not. I guess I just have to rearrange my schedule.
They're both on town meeting floor anyway. I mean, we kept them both as articles, so.
But we have to do this stuff or else we can't.
Yeah, actually I have to physically go there and look at it.
You have to have the viewing, which is, it's one of those, the viewing is one of those great things that Massachusetts law has that has carried forward since the beginning, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right. So is there any questions from the board about where we are in the process?
Not really. I think everything's pretty well set.
All right. Is there anything anybody in the audience want to say anything about what we're doing and what their next process, our next step is in this?
Yes. Our understanding is that the issue of ownership is still unanswered. And so we are not clear then on the. If you're saying that this can go forward as it is now and town can vote on it and the town can accept it, that's fine, but our understanding is that there is a gap there because of the ownership issues.
Mr. Barry Roberts has represented that he owns the parcel.
Okay, and our town council accepts that?
Yes.
Okay.
And that part was still in a deed, correct?
Right.
The road itself in Barry's name.
Under
whatever the corporation is.
Let me look it up. Let me not guess.
Mr. Roberts' lawyer has represented to us that he does not own the road. And that's under the Mass General law, which says that once he sold all the lots along the side, that the abutters then own to the middle of the road.
Now, there's a book and page here with the Hampshire County Registry of Deeds.
Which says that Mr. Roberts still owns it and hasn't?
Well, it's under a corporation name that isn't Barry Roberts per se. It's Roberts and Associates.
So our town council has looked at that and they say that Mr. Roberts still owns it. And Mr. Roberts, as his attorney, says no, he doesn't.
Well, then we have a conflict.
So then, if we're willing to accept that he still owns it,
that's great.
Then everyone else would have to represent.
I spoke to him, he's my cousin, and he said he's willing to get sold to the town for a buck.
Yeah. Okay, so everyone hears from the right road, right?
Yeah.
I got it.
Okay. Is this everybody from the road?
I'm from Mount Pleasant, but I have footage along our Holly.
Who's missing? Are we missing one or two owners?
Well, we're missing a couple of resident owners. We're missing landlord. We have several rental properties, and we're missing those folks. Then there's another abutter. No, I'm not even sure.
Ken Parker is in Europe.
Okay.
Right.
So does everybody, just as a general, we've never seen this many people here, so I was just going to ask some general questions if you don't mind, okay?
Sure.
So is everybody on the street pretty much interested in the town taking it over?
Yes, please.
It's falling apart.
Yes. Yeah. What happens?
On a daily basis.
It's terrible. It's
lasted
terrible.
Pretty long, though.
Why don't you fix your road?
Yeah.
You guys have been taking care
We've
of it for 42
years. We've been doing it for 40 years. You've been
yes.
doing
it. I don't see how Tommy supports.
So, okay, so no one is going to argue if Mr. Roberts says, yes, I own this road.
Absolutely not.
All right, so
if he files a quick claim,
he did that
sells
already.
It for a buck, whatever. That takes care of the whole issue.
That takes care of the ownership issue.
Right.
You still have to convince town meeting members to vote to take the road in a public way. And that's a whole other thing. As we go through this process, that's the one thing that you have to convince people of. And
well, if Chapter 90 money pays for the road, assuming you file for that money.
We always do.
Or somebody does.
Yeah.
So
there's no cost to the town.
That's actually how this all came about originally. Putting it on Chapter 90 list and finding out it's not a town-approved road.
Right.
So let's not say that, because if we were to say it doesn't cost the town anything, it does cost the town
sure.
something.
Yes,
because
does.
Chapter 90 is based on a formula, and
right.
adding your small road to the formula gives us maybe $10. So if we wait until we have enough $10 to pave your road, there won't be no road. So you think there's no road now, but so there is a cost to accepting your road, even though you use Chapter 90 to pave it, because you're taking Chapter 90 money away from somewhere else to now maintain this extra road. But you do get a small piece at increasing your Chapter 90.
And the other major concern on that road, off the subject of Laurel, is the sewer line that services that whole area, Woodlawn, Highland Circle, Euro Road, Mount Warner Road, Crystal, Quinlan, Frollo, is all on sewer now, and that pump station. That's all on sewer, and that sewer line goes right down the middle of the road now. So,
right.
which the town does almost.
The sewer line.
Yes.
Right.
I'm sorry. So, what are you saying about that?
Nothing. I'm just that's just a point for me to vote to accept it.
Oh, I see. Yes.
I'm behind accepting that road.
That's right, and the pumping station is
yeah.
at the end. All right, but the point of confusion comes up because we were told by the town administrator that we would need to produce title searches and that the select board had asked us to do that.
So in the interim since...
So is that being set aside now?
Well, in the interim from that time, Mr. Roberts came forward and gave us this, but now it seems
and
so...
And all that should be in that book. Of the property.
So what you should probably do next is just verify with Mr. Roberts he owns it, and that is
he has verified that he doesn't.
Well, his lawyer has told you he
didn't. Doesn't.
That's correct.
Until he's confronted that he does, he's going to say that.
I believe in return what the lawyer was saying is that he's not liable.
No, the lawyer said he doesn't own the road.
But he signed a quick.
I mean, I would love to slip this by and say, great, you'll accept.
Yeah.
But I have a feeling that we'll leave this meeting and then get a call saying, oh, by the way.
Well, if Mr. So I would talk to Mr. Roberts again and say, we accept the documentation that was given. It's his road. And we're willing to proceed the town meeting saying he's the owner of the road. And we're voting to accept the road from him and make it a town
yeah,
way.
If he's willing, if his lawyer is willing to sell the road for a dollar and come up with a document for us to review and sign, I don't see why we wouldn't do it.
Well, is that quick claim an adequate document that you already have?
If that book is correct and
yeah.
the documentation and the deeds.
We were talking with counsel about this just the other day as so we were going through the review of the warrant. And you know, the question of ownership based upon this information was not something that he raised with me. There were some piddle and other things that he was talking about, but that doesn't affect what we're talking about today. And it doesn't affect our requirement to hold a layout meeting and vote on this road, and it has to happen on next week, or else we're going to be out of time for the fall town meeting.
Rather than us contacting Mr. Roberts, I'm assuming, since he's the one that's submitting this quitclaim deed, somebody representing the town is in touch with him.
I don't believe so. I believe he submitted it a while back, and then he...
To
the town. That's what he submitted to us, we're willing to accept, but you just said, no, it's not true.
All right, I'll call him.
I'll call, because I've been talking to his lawyer, so...
He's my cousin, so I'll just talk to him.
So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to keep going with the process. No one wants us to stop the process,
no,
right?
No, please don't stop the process.
So we're going to have our hearing tomorrow at 4:30.
Viewing. It's at 5 o'clock on Holly.
At 5 o'clock.
Yes, we'll be there waiting for you.
4:30
at Washington.
And one of us or two of us will be at there.
Yep, I'll be there.
Both of them? Or?
Yep.
Okay, at least one of us will be there.
What does the viewing involve? When you come to the road, what
are you going
to
drive
down
it?
It's a very archaic, it's very old, you know, I guess.
Driving down it.
The thing to do is to, I mean, you're just there to see the roads there. There's actually land there. There's nobody's had a house on it. No one has a pig pen on it or a cow paddock on it or something like that. That's pretty much the reason for having the viewing.
So we don't have to do anything. We just, you.
Cookies are nice.
Cookies.
I didn't say that. But no, that's all. It's really it. It's just a formality. And then once we do that, then we back in the meeting, we'll have a vote to say yes, we recommend accepting it. I recommend taking it to town meeting to accept it.
So just so that we're all clear, tomorrow it's a site visit. It's going to be very quick. Ms. Kagan is going to physically view the road, and then she's going to find something else to do. And then next week, the 14th, the select board will take their formal vote to lay out Laurel Drive and Holly Road.
Okay, and then you'll go to town meeting.
And you'll be able to get in contact with them tonight or tomorrow?
Yep.
And see if you can get that document to us?
I'm making my note right now.
So next Wednesday is really the drop dead date for now, if you don't mind.
Okay, and then the other question we had was a temporary patch for this year before winter sets in.
No, I won't. I personally will not say yes to that. It's not an accepted road. We've already gone through the process saying it's not a public way. I do not wish to be the person who says we're going to spend public funds on a private road right now. The acceptance will go through. The acceptance will be official. If it's voted by town meeting, it'll be official 7 days after town meeting
right after
concludes.
Town meeting, it can be patched.
Awesome.
And then there can be discussions about what to do with the road. Right. But between now and then, I would say no.
For the winter, mm-hmm. Will you continue your 42, 43 year, 45 year tradition of plowing it?
I think we've always plowed it. So.
You always patched it.
Patched it and resurfaced
well,
it.
Well, we're not getting that, so let's just go with the plowing.
But after town meeting, that discussion can take place, you're saying.
So, yeah.
I'm sorry to be late, but is there a reason why it's been patched every other year until this year that we put the petition in?
I guess we seem to think it was our road.
Well, you do own property on the road.
We do own property at the end, yes.
And you have trucks that go down it every day, which makes it worse. So why don't you have a vested interest in the condition now?
In 7 days they will.
In 7 days?
Yes, yeah. 7 days after town meeting.
Okay.
Any other comments? Good to see everybody. Thank you for coming.
I don't want to beat a dead horse. We've been talking about this for how many months?
February.
Okay. And maybe I just want to, we should just let it go, and you've said it looks like it's being accepted and it looks like the Roberts, but we've been told, like we've been told a myriad of things that were not as straightforward as what you're telling us, and we've had like moments of really questioning.
But you guys don't know who owns the road. Internally here, amongst the 15 people here, we have one person saying one thing, and we have a lawyer saying the other.
Right, because
so we're as confused
as
you.
Board, they came, wasn't it about the planning board said that there had to be a title search?
Oh, we were told the select board said that your council told you there needed to be, and then that we had to provide it.
But then we were provided a document, whether it was provided by you or Mr. Roberts, don't know where
this
it came
was
from.
Before.
I thought it was after.
The timeline was that Mr. Roberts had provided the quick claim,
and
then we were told that there was no...
It wasn't the plan.
I received a document about 4 or 5 months ago. I can't remember exactly when I received additional documentation, or just recently.
You
and
just
that's
received
for the layout of the road itself, the way it's shown on a sewer plan?
This is for the notice for the layout of the road,
okay,
which was sent to Mr. Barry Roberts as the owner of the road.
Awesome. Okay, good.
Okay,
excellent.
So we'll see you
I'm
tomorrow.
Good. I'm good.
5 o'clock. Call the road.
Cookies.
Yes. With cookies and cobbles.
What kind do you like?
I don't eat cookies.
Chocolate chip.
Have we agreed who will contact Mr. Roberts and with what message?
Glenn.
Me.
And the message is that the town would like to buy the road
for a dollar. Very quickly.
Is that the message?
The message is we
need
to verify
he owns it. Yeah, I will tell him to get whatever form he needs to get to the town within the next few days so that they know that he owns the road and he's signing over the quick claim. And for a dollar or whatever the hell it is.
Hasn't he already given him the quitclaim though?
But they're saying
because
the lawyer said he doesn't own it.
You got two conflicting stories here right now.
So I think everyone understands this.
I know.
No, but Mr. Nixon's saying he has on file the quitclaim from Mr. Roberts. So if he already has it, he has it.
And you just said in this meeting on tape that that's his lawyer said no, he doesn't own the land.
So you want it to happen again.
So we need to verify that is correct.
It's a mere 7:30 at night. I'm sure that phone call can be made rather quickly.
Oh, you betcha. Hopefully he's home.
Kissing cousins, right?
Oh, you betcha.
Just tell him it wasn't my idea. Okay. So we'll see you tomorrow at 5.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, do we want to talk about, we want to bring our pride friends in?
Good luck.
So we've opened the hearing, we took a little recess, so you can join us.
I was wondering, yeah, okay. Thank you.
At their request.
You'd like to be.
You'd love to be.
So you're okay with the fact that this is the four of us? Or?
Yes.
Okay.
Again, to reconvene, next select member Keegan's here now. Just briefly, we opened it. Our concern was just at the time there's only three individuals, mm-hmm. So we did just ask to postpone until they were able to arrive. And so now I believe that if we have to reopen to move the hearing, or I guess as an update, we're here August 12th. We have one little remember that. We got again looking to apply for a beer and wine license on a yet to be developed parcel. Subsequent to that day, I think we've taken some significant steps, in my opinion. I'd like to briefly give you an overview, unless there's any objection to that.
No, go ahead.
Again, all the utilities at the site have been disconnected. We went first through all the buildings themselves, took out a lot of stuff. There was debris and material still inside all those facilities. Old Time magazines, old LPs, everything. The maintenance crew had a field day with it. So that's all cleaned up. Again, we then had to do two of the properties, I believe, if not three, needed abatement. So we, again, contacted two or three abatement companies that since have commenced and also been completed. Also, we met with the assistant tree warden with respect to the trees and the vegetation around the site, specifically Old Bay Road, which is jurisdiction of the town. Got confirmation that there wouldn't be any concerns with respect to those trees. When the time comes, if you want to take any of those vegetation down in the tree line in the back of the property. In September, again, we established temporary utility service for the abatement, that being the electrical box out there, as well as we've applied and discussed with both the Conservation Commission as well as the fire chief with an underground storage tank license. At that point, we've engaged on a number of occasions with the Conservation Commission. We actually have a public hearing with them with a notice of intent on for next Tuesday, the 13th. Conservation Commission was asked to review the storage license. At that point, they deferred, they'd prefer to have that reviewed at the time of their of the public hearing on next Tuesday. Again, we've also applied for a state access permit. The only thing left with respect to that is capping for the capping the water is a rider. In fact, Mr. Bold, I believe, met today with the individual. We have plans to do that. We've also applied for the demolition permit. I believe there's only a couple of, two steps left?
Yes.
That being the rider itself, as well as the completion or certification with respect to the abatement. At that point, the buildings will be ready for demolition. Lastly, again, I met, I think, or at least discussed, I should say, with members of the planning board, probably once every 2 weeks with respect to our plans. Again, dealing with everything from the potential of the rapid transit with respect to the Route 9 project, which has just come through MassDOT. Also with respect to MISA, the Endangered Species Act, we had a scientist out there looking for, I think it was red or green dragons, verifying that there was no concerns with respect to that vegetation, as well as a couple other questions. It is obviously in the Village Overlay District, as well as the 100-year floodplain. So we've gotten everything, I think. At first blush, I know that the planning board has some questions about our parking. Subsequent to that, we've obviously amended, in my opinion, appropriately to meet their concerns with respect to that. Obviously, there hasn't, it's my understanding, there hasn't been a gas station built in Hadley in some time. So with respect to the quota and interpreting parking compensation, I think we're in a position now to meet those concerns. Mr. Boldick was able to present these informally to the planning board last night. I believe there weren't any major concerns. I think, in fact, only one comment they had was with respect to whether or not there would be a right turn only onto Route 9. And of course, that would be the case as is required by the state with respect to that. Again, with respect to our MIFA certification, we received approval, received state approval. And so now I think we stand in a position to ask to reconsider, reevaluate our request for the beer and wine license at this time.
So have you actually, you haven't formally submitted your plans to the planning board because you need to decide what size building to build, and that's based on whether we give you the beer or wine license.
That's correct.
So this is like a chicken and egg type discussion.
Precisely.
Okay.
There's the same issue, if I may add, between conservation and fire as to who signs it first. You know, the form says one thing will happen, but they don't both agree on that, so we're doing a little mini circle there too.
Okay, so you've actually gotten a letter from Natural Heritage?
Yes, we have.
From the state, from Massachusetts. And then we submitted through the NOI, is going to be resubmitted to the federal National Heritage to verify, but we've had an independent scientist who obviously certified us to swear and affirm that there's no concerns with respect to the endangered vegetation, endangered species, and it's been confirmed that there's not on any of the parcels.
All right, and then that's your plan so far?
Yes, Jim said I could show you that part of it. This is what the building would look like. Very colonial. We think it needs, we checked all your requirements, and it, we feel comfortable that it meets all the requirements for designing the building. Front, sides, real brick, real shingles, etc. Signage meets your requirements also. Internally, let me come back to the plan. Let's get the overview first. This is the site, Bay Road, Russell Street. This is the Getty parcel. We're still optimistic that someday we might be able to do something on that because, in fact, we were just talking to Tim, and they'll be looking, they need some very serious variances here to use it for anything, and they're so onerous that it's going to be a very uphill fight. So we think that'll someday be back on the market. We're still, this is of course our parcel. This says 1.4 acres, but it's been increased that now it's, I think it's about 1.8 acres. So it's a very large parcel and plenty of room for all the parking that we need, meets all the setback requirements, 50 feet, no parking in front, drive-up window, ample roadway for future, and then that leaves us with an available parcel in the back and available parcel here, where we'll be able to put a for lease sign once this is open. Landscaping plan. We didn't bring any of the technical plans because we didn't think that was what we're involved with tonight, but we have a full set of technical plans for drainage and all of the utilities and all the things that happen. So here's a blow up of the site. We're using a lot of trees as opposed to low vegetation because they help with replenishing the oxygen and all. And the site is big enough to handle them, so we have those all around. We do have low trees in the front for visibility.
Okay. So what's the drive-through for?
Drive-through is for over here, inside the building. Pride runs their own cafe bakery, much like Dunkin'. This will not be a Dunkin'. We have six Dunkin's now, and have made up, and we're not doing anymore. And we don't intend to. I assure you of that. So here's what, now you see what the inside looks like. Over here is the drive-up. So when you come into a Pride nowadays, we sell as much food inside as we do store items. It's about an equal mix. So you come into one of these two doors, main sales counter here, which services everything, and this whole left side is a food alcove, lots of seating. It's basically a food court. A refrigerated case here of pre-prepared foods made at our own commissary. Some seating across the front on higher, you know, counter type thing. Then we have a full deli, sliced meats, cheeses, everything. Runs into, flows into a bakery with fresh baked products every day. Coffee sold through the drive-up window or people walking up. Then this is self-service coffee, hot dogs, condiments, that type of thing. Full pizza in the back, full Subway. So you can see the food's all in that alcove. Convenience store in the middle. Here, obviously, is what we said is the issue, and that is the building would be one size if you all were to approve the beer and wine. So that would be in this area. This dairy cooler is for non-dairy, non-alcohol products. This is the one for beer and wine only, and this would all be locked in off hours. So this is regular, then you run into bathrooms and utility rooms and storage, and it would be a different design, much closed up, if this were not approved.
So
we have these now.
Those shelves are all beer and wine?
Some of the shelving is what we call lay down, where the wine's horizontal. And then the rest is actually floor displays, but it's on base so that there's nothing on the floor.
Is there anything else you want to tell us?
Happy to answer questions.
All right. Any questions from the board?
Our schedule would be that we would spend the next several months still just going around the circle of getting permits, and then we would, however, we'll knock down the buildings before Christmas as we were asked to have the trees cut down before Christmas, and then finish our permitting through the winter and break ground in the spring.
So when do you expect it to be open? In spring?
Yes. Well, it wouldn't be open in spring. We'd break ground in the spring, so it wouldn't be open until beginning of summer. It's a big job.
Yeah.
It's an expensive job.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
I got one for our chief. Has anything been remedied over there? Have you had calls over there since the last meeting?
We haven't had any calls like we were getting as far as people being in the building or anything like that I know about. But, you know, the concern remains the same as far as those buildings go. So I don't want to say I'm torn, but I would really love to see those buildings come down, that property get cleaned up for that half of it. I think Selectman Devine spoke to it at the last meeting, not only is it obviously, you know, not a nice looking site, but it does add an aspect of danger when the officers have to go in there for a breaking and entering call or something like that. At the same time, the proposal of the, you know, the liquor store, the beer and wine, so close to the highway, ease of access. We do have theft in this town. As a matter of fact, you know, I can recall 10 years ago actually catching one of the people who was breaking into the other Pride at the other end of town. So certainly don't have any statistics to back up the fact that liquor stores may get broken into more than regular convenience stores, but being that close to the highway is a concern of mine.
Getty was actually robbed quite often on that corner.
The Getty Mart, actually, we did have lots of breaks into the store when it was closed. We did, I believe it was actually robbed, I think once or twice. Cumberland Farms has been robbed, Phillips 66 has been robbed, and when I say robbed, people need to understand that someone actually walked in either with some type of a weapon or threatened some type of a weapon and robbed them. That's very different from breaking into a closed store, but that has happened as well. So as I said, do I have statistics to say that a package store is broken into more or robbed more than a convenience store? No, but it being so close to 91, off the exit, robbed the store, right back on the highway.
Could I respond to that?
Hold on one second. There's a building. They said they've applied for their building demolition permits.
I have the application for the demo permits. Mr. Bolduc and I talked to him before. He's done the asbestos. I'm waiting for the documentation on that and a couple other documents with regard to cutting off some of the services.
Okay. So he could actually probably start demolition maybe a little sooner if he gets all that and gets his permits for.
I would hope that stuff would be coming in quite quickly and I can issue that permit, yeah.
Okay.
When was the request for the permit?
Probably a week and a half.
Is there any other questions from the board?
Yeah. No, we asked you when you were here in August to at least clean up some of the brush around those buildings. And it doesn't even seem like you made the attempt for security reasons. Not for our own police department, our own officers, and your people the same.
I'd like to answer three things you brought up and be happy to answer all of them, okay? First, with regards to the brush, we've had people working there almost every day. We've had to get, as Jim said, it was a considerable job cleaning out the buildings. It took roll-off after roll-off of trash out of all of them. So we've had someone there almost all the time. We did clear enough brush so we could access the buildings. And since that time, we've had engineers and people and surveyors and everybody in and out of there almost all the time. We haven't had, the asbestos people have been working for 1 month to remove all the asbestos from the buildings, because they're big, old buildings, and I won't tell you the price tag, but it was a very, very large sum, and we're not done yet. As for when we applied for the permit, we've done this before, so we understand the procedure, and we know that the building commissioner can't issue the permit until the asbestos is removed and we've received our certificate. Now, so you know also, after we get an engineer in there to define the asbestos, we then have to send it off to somewhere, which takes a month before they'll give you the asbestos permit. So there was a month right there where we just waited. We got quotes, then they did the work. We had to wait a month before we could get that, and now we're still waiting for the actual certificate that the job has been completed, and we know that. So there was no need to rush up here and fill out the permit, because we knew it would just sit on Mr. Neihardt's desk until everything was done. Similarly, we've contracted with a local contractor, Taylor Davis, to do all the work in the street. All the that had to go through Mass Highway with bonds and all that type of stuff. I assure you, ladies and gentlemen, we have been working on this from the morning after we left that meeting in August. Okay? Now, I'd like to address the comments about robbery.
If you'd like to, it's...
I would love to, okay. Because they deserve an answer, okay? First, Pride is a very upfront, organized, professional company. We have more security cameras, and we have a loss prevention, an internal, our own internal loss prevention department of four people, a manager and three analysts. And all they do all day is watch cameras, which are digital, not the old analog. We were the first to go to digital. We have, I bet we have a dozen cameras in each store, and we don't have any theft. Because if we do, loss prevention calls the store right away and says, you better check on somebody in aisle six or whatever. So we don't have internal theft. We watch our pennies very well. As for break-ins, this will be a 24-hour store. All our new big ones are 24-hour stores. They are very busy, and so there won't be any break-ins. Yes, the one further down the Hadley on the Amherst line has some, but by then the traffic has petered out to the point that it doesn't justify 24 hours. And so people were coming in the back. Okay, they were breaking in back window at the time. That stopped a long time ago when we reduced our cigarettes and secured the cigarettes better, because they were just coming in to steal cigarettes. We haven't had a break in there for years. As for robberies, when you have a busy place with a lot of glass across the front, like we do, with a lot of people coming and going, and trust me, this will be a busy store, there are no robberies. I can tell you that in 35 stores that we have now, we had one robbery last year, and it's an old store in a questionable area. They came in, they got $150. When they realized that we had good controls on money, that they weren't going to get any more, that's been it. But robberies are basically a thing of the past as far as Pride is concerned, because of our cameras and because of our internal system and all that.
Good question about employee turnover. I mean, I would imagine, I mean, just generally speaking, that whether it's Pride or Phillips 66 or any of these places, Cumberland Farms, you probably experience a fair amount of turnover with employees.
Ours is among the best, and it's going to sound like we're bragging. Ours is among the best in the industry. Here's why. We pay more. Mm-hmm. We take good care of our people. We had full benefits years before they were mandated. And you come to any of our stores and you will say the same people over and over. Our manager, Robin in Hadley, has been there for several years, and it had the same as much of her staff. In Northampton, they've been regulars there for years. There's always a few, I must say. There's always 10 to 15% that turn over, and unfortunately those are the people who unfortunately can't keep a job for their own reasons. But we're very proud of our employees, and we have a lot of people with 5, 10, 15 year, 20 year pins. Okay? You will find us to be a very good neighbor.
John, do you have any more questions?
That was the only question I had. John had already asked one of the chief before.
Do you have any more questions?
Not sure.
I have a question. So I'm just curious, what are you going to do with the Pride at the other end of town?
We'll leave it.
That's going to stay there?
Totally, yeah. That, people look at that and say, gee, that station's not a busy station. But I can tell you, that station sells well over 1 million gallons of fuel a year, okay? And sells another $1 million of inside.
Okay, I was just wondering.
It's a good store.
All right.
It's a good store.
So, is there any other comments? So we're being asked to, we have a couple of choices here. Choice one is to deny the liquor permit. Choice two is to approve it. And choice three is to say we need more information. So we've had the hearing. It's time, I guess, to make a decision.
Could I add one more thing? If you are uncomfortable with the brush or the demolition, you could always put a condition on it, or conditions on it to that effect, that if we don't do it by a certain period of time, you know, you could pull the license, or you wouldn't even issue the license. We're just looking for some direction tonight so we can keep it going. But we're happy with any conditions you might want to put on it.
I thought with the safety concerns in August, we made the condition was that you did a little bit more than you actually are doing over there, as far as the brush and the safety issues. Like I said, especially for the officers that have to go there on calls. And I know you did a lot with the fire departments and let them use the buildings and things like that. Right. But this was another issue that was addressed that we needed to bring forward to you.
It was not my understanding that you wanted the brush down right away. It was my understanding you wanted the buildings down right away. And
I believe it was Mrs. Chungalo that wanted the brush and the buildings gone, and it was me who asked if you could do something with at least the brush before the next meeting.
Okay. That I apologize. With all the things we got hammered with that night, I didn't catch that part of it.
So.
Okay? But I can tell you, and I'll bet you, if you're all familiar with Rocky Mountain Land Clearing, I called them within days of that meeting, and they're lined up and ready to go. Okay? And they will be going in right after they're done clearing out the buildings and stuff. But it was, and we had to hold off on them because we had to get the tree warden in because, as you know, there's a requirement that we have to be approved on all the trees. And we also couldn't knock it down till the National Heritage, not the National, but our, the engineers that we are, Vanessa Hang and Brooksland, came, had their people come in and take care of all the plants.
Endangered species.
And the endangered species. So it couldn't just happen the next day. There were a lot of things that had to happen. We walked out of here and made a checklist that long of things we had to do. And then we prioritized them. And I apologize if we didn't take the brush out.
So VHB is your engineer? All right. So are we comfortable issuing a permit now? I guess our fourth option is we could continue it again. But they actually do need an answer so they can move along with their building.
Yeah, I mean, I think right now, I can't think of additional information that I would want in order to be able to make a recommendation at this point. And I think in fairness to, you know, Mr. Boulder, who's trying to get this building up, having us decide one way or the other so that he can move forward, I think seems appropriate at this point. Yeah. And I'm happy to frame out my thinking. I mean, I don't, are we going to have some conversation about where we're leaning and why?
Make a motion and look for a second and open it for discussion.
Would you like to, someone make the motion?
Not me.
So I'll go ahead and say where I'm leaning, just to kick this off. We don't have to have a motion to have more discussion. I'm leaning towards yes. There's a lot of caveats to my yes. But then again, the one thing is that when we have problems in this type of establishment, we always, as the licensing authority, have the ability to take the license away. So if we say yes and we have issues, that is always our ability to do that. That means you have some empty space in the store and it looks a little weird.
Okay.
But you're coming towards me, towards us, and with you're coming to us to say you are going to do this and you're going to manage it in a good way and respectfully and so forth. And at some point we have to take face value of that and give you a chance to do it. But knowing we have the power to take it away.
We understand.
So I'm leaning towards yes, and that's pretty much my reason why.
Like I said, I kind of agree with Joyce back in August that if he did a little bit more of the brush cleaning, at least for safety reasons. I'm still behind it, but nothing looking at that property, as far as the people driving by right now, seem to think anything was done to it. I understand everything, all the points you made, for sure. They're all justified, but the physical condition of that property is in rough shape.
So I'm actually leaning against the beer and wine license, and the reason why is the proximity to the highway is problematic for me. I think the good news is it would bring additional business to our town, but I think that business would then potentially turn around and leave again. I think that having the beer and wine at that location is, I'm afraid we'd just be kicking the can down the road to have reports from our police department to say that we are getting additional activity at that end of town that, quite frankly, we're not staffed to handle. in my opinion. And we've also had a request from the Campus Coalition. I think everybody received a letter from the folks at the university and the area communities. This is the group that has been formed to really try to curb drinking and substance abuse, especially in the younger age groups. And, you know, it does call into question how many places in town do we need to be selling alcohol. I think, you know, a lot of people are coming off of the highway. That's a logical stopping point. I'm sure that the store is going to do extremely well. I've no doubt of that. I'm sure it's going to be very lucrative for you, just given the location. But I can see college kids picking up the beer and then, you know, heading on through, right through the center of our town. And I think we're trying to minimize that, not encourage more. And it will likely have an impact on some of the other smaller businesses in town that have been here for quite a while. Fonzie's a little bit up the road, Four Seasons up the road, Liquors 44, probably not. And I do worry about the turnover. I mean, it's just the reality of the convenience stores. I'm envisioning a scenario where, again, I'm sure Mr. Boldick would do everything he could to hire an appropriately trained, seasoned manager for the store that can keep good control of the beer and wine area. But 24/7, you're going to have a lot of different people working in that store, and I'm not convinced, and I don't have any statistics in front of me, but I'm not convinced that a store with that type of turnover can do a better job than, quite frankly, more of a mom-and-pop store that's selling alcohol solely, controlling the checking of IDs and the like. I think, you know, again, it's anecdotal. I don't have data per se, but it certainly seems to me that when you read a lot of the kind of sting operations that are put out there, that people make mistakes, especially when they're only there for a certain amount of time, they're on the younger side, all of that. So for those reasons, I'm certainly wishing the business great success at its location, and I'm certainly assuming that the site will be cleaned up appropriately as has been committed. But I'm not in favor of the beer and wine license.
I'll be voting against. The property was bought in 07. I mean, I'm sorry, 08. And for 7 years, it's looked like it is, like it does today. We're talking about what's been done in the last month and a half, not what's been done in the last 7 years. And for 7 years, people have had a look at that piece of property. Last time you were here, it was Chairman Mooring said to you, heard us, you know what you need to do to win this back at Fraz Friends. And virtually nothing aesthetically has been done to the exterior of that piece of property to make it more palatable to the neighbors who have looked at it for 7 years. And I think it's imperative that you guys, if this comes up again down the road and the property's been fixed and rectified, which was your last chance to bring it forward, in my thought process, I think everybody that was up here expected that building to be, things to move at a great pace based on the conversation that you had. We also had conversations with you regarding people who had called you and commented regarding problems that was with problems on that building. Our fire chief, our building inspector, and Mr. Benjamin, and you acknowledged none of those comments. You said that you didn't know it and you didn't know anything about that piece of property being an eyesore. And I'll tell you something else. I ride by that piece of property 3 times every single day. My house is on West Street. I'm not directly next to it, but I ride by it 3 times a day, and I have not seen any sort of activity there that you discussed this evening. Okay? That's just, I'm telling you, I ride by there all the time, sir. All due respect.
This public document, no?
Can you
get them a copy of it?
That's
do they have a copy of it?
I don't know, but I'm pretty sure that they do.
Is it possible to address this?
Well, I guess really the question is yes, you want to continue moving or whether you wish to kind of withdraw it. No.
We would like to withdraw.
We wish to accept the withdrawal.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
So there's a motion to accept the withdrawal.
Accept the withdrawal.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We hear you loud and clear when we work on it.
Thank you, sir.
You're very welcome.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All
right. Why don't we go on to the warrant, since we have a nice warrant group here.
Yes, look at those eager faces.
So we need to wrap up the warrant tonight and sign the warrant tonight. And this is for those of you who are at home. We have our fall, our special town meeting at
October 22nd, 7 p.m. over at Hopkins Academy.
Okay.
Hit me.
You could have kept the chairs as protection if you wanted to.
For us, you
mean, right? Hold it down for us. Okay, so.
Strings tight.
He can't hit me back here.
Let's move on through the warrant here and try to wrap this up. So article number one is the 2015 shortfalls. We've already voted on that. We're spending $39,206 from free cash to do that. While we're doing this, so do we want to assign positions and who wants to talk it? Well, Joyce is here.
I was going to do that on your next meeting because still articles are sort of coming in and out.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So article number two is 2016 budget adjustments. We need to decide to if we wish to give the step and COLAs to the non-union at this time. We looked at this last time and it's roughly, I'm going to say this wrong, 35,000 total.
Yeah, something a little bit north of that, because we had to increase the, for the police chief, we had to increase the salary to reflect his contract, contractual arrangements. So it's a little bit north of that, call it $45,000. So for the 1.5% COLA and the step that you asked me to calculate last time.
Okay, so we're taking that from free cash as well?
It's going to be a combination because we're spread out all over the two enterprise funds, the general fund and TV5.
Okay, is that in this number here?
Yes, so.
So the step in COLA and the other increases in the FY16 budget, which includes $245,000 in OPEB, that comes to the $500,000 number on our little cheat sheet here.
Yeah, would it be helpful if I just quickly ran down the items? I think it just takes a minute to do that. So select board on their salaries, the only adjustment would be for Bridget and for Janice. The accountant salaries and expenses are going to be combined into one line. There's no net increase there, but that will cover your agreement that you have with the vendor for the rest of the year, as well as pay for the audit. The assessor's other salaries would include the Dan and Janice. Treasurer's other salaries would be for Joan. Tax collector's salary would be for Jessica, and her other salaries would be for part of Janice and for Pat. Town clerk's salary would be for Susan. Other salaries would be for Kim. The insurance we can go down because the quote came in a little less than we thought. Town hall expenses went up by $4,000 to do the board docs. Police salaries, this is mainly the chief and your assistant. Fire salaries, this would be the fire chief, the lieutenant, and the office manager. Communication salaries is only the custodian. Building inspector salaries would be for staff in his department. Gas inspector salary and plumbing inspector salary is small increases there. Highway construction salaries would be for the non-union people only. Same for the wastewater salaries. Wastewater debt and principal and interest has to increase slightly to cover a potential shortfall there. Water salaries, again, the non-union people. Council on Aging salaries, public library salaries, park and rec commission. Other salaries would be for the director and the assistant. Long-term debt principal with an increase to cover a potential shortfall, but that would be netted out by an increase in taxation since his debt excluded. Same for the long-term debt interest. Workers' comp came, we budgeted too low, and so we have to adjust that by $15,000. And then OPEB would be fully funded for our target of $245,000 for the year.
So is that how we wish to go? Comments, questions?
Okay, yeah, I have a question. I just want to make sure I can reconcile. So you know the spreadsheet here?
Yes.
Can you just help me out? So I'm just looking at the numbers at the bottom of the page on Article 2.
Mm-hmm.
And it says raise and appropriate the sum of 13,660, but this is 13,466. So I don't know. Are these numbers here?
So the top part of this would be, let me make sure we have the right.
Yeah.
There's so many of these. Okay.
So
that is the correct one. The top part of this would be the actions we took at the annual town meeting.
Yep.
And then the bottom part of it is the proposed actions for the special town meeting. So 13,466,525 is the raise and appropriate for the omnibus budget.
Okay, yeah, but I'm just looking at
David,
see right here. Have those numbers just not been changed to reflect the spreadsheet now?
That's correct.
Okay, that's right. Okay.
That's correct.
All right. So these would be changed to this?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Okay, so we are comfortable with this number.
So what was the aggregate change again? I'm sorry.
For this item? Or
this
yeah, just for this.
It says $13,466.
Yeah, but the change, I mean,
change
from.
Is 500, $503.87 from free cash. There is some change from sewer and water as well, and there's some change from
So the 503.877. And
has been
the
off?
Biggest chunk of that is the OPEB.
Yes, right. So the change between the bottom line and not going into the complexities of the enterprise funds or so forth, $308,888, of which $245 is the OPEB.
Okay, so I just want to set the OPEB aside for a second because I look at that differently. So 504 from free cash of that
245.
Yeah, so I'm just saying if we take the 500 and back out the 245, so we're adding $250,000 in operating to our budget. That's going to roll forward
so,
into next year.
So the story was that we went into annual town meeting with mm-hmm. the balanced budget.
Mm-hmm.
A week later, the state came out with a revised cherry sheet, which increased our assessments by well over $100,000. So we were out of balance by the first week of June, which was reported to you. So that effect upon our finances based upon decisions made at the state level, as well as the addition that we're making to the budgets, results in a need for free cash of $503,000.
Yeah, I just want to be clear again. This isn't a one-time thing. We're rolling this, so we're
down
rolling
down
this.
Roll.
The only thing that's one time is OPEB.
That's why I said let's pull OPEB out.
Yeah.
Because an OPEB, quite frankly, is discretionary, if you will. We have some level of discretion on what we do with OPEB, but everything else we're building into our.
We haven't balanced the budget in the last 2 years I've been here, and I don't know how long before that, but.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the one thing we may not be rolling down is the assessment from the state. We don't know what that'll be next year.
Correct.
Because it could go down, and then we could get the money we're paying this time. That's the one thing you have to. That's the one thing in the budget is we don't know when the assessments come in. That's the assessments, and that's what mm-hmm. it is.
You know, in over 10 years, you put the meals tax on, and you taxed and spent all of that.
We may not tonight.
I'm just saying, our record is not very good here. And the numbers just keep going up.
Me too.
So I was making an observation.
Yes.
Okay. I think we need to make a lot of these adjustments. The question is the, so, and then the salary piece of it, the COLA and the steps of that increase in the aggregate was?
About 45,000.
45, yeah, okay.
Something like that.
40 something thousand. Okay.
It's 45 or 47, I think we figured out last week.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
This year's, but I mean, going ahead and making these changes, I mean, what I think we need to understand if we go ahead and vote this is that for this budget cycle coming up, there are going to have to be some changes. So,
there's more changes coming as well because we haven't resolved three contracts.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, we are using everything we have to make our budgets work.
Yep.
And the tax rate we have is what it is, but what we're raising from revenue barely covers what we need to do.
Mm-hmm.
And doesn't cover anything that we shouldn't be doing to add to it.
Correct.
And we only went 1.8% this year. Well, last year, actually, for an increase in the taxes. And the water and sewer has been the height of the conversation amongst everyone here. And if that was balanced with the tax rate a little bit, you wouldn't have to be going out to the water and sewer rates like you're going to have to here pretty soon. This is a bad ball of wax going downhill fast here.
Well,
2 years ago when I got here, I said it before through the tri-board meetings, we need to get a handle on this stuff.
We're spending an awful lot of money catching up with a lot of things that haven't been addressed for an awful long time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things that we absolutely have to do. The money's available this year. There's a tremendous amount of money that's being spent on the buildings this year. And for great improvements, there's a tremendous amount of money that's in the budget this year for capital improvements. We're able to add a lot of things this year because the money is available to us. One of the money's shortfalls that we don't have this year that we've had in the past is the fact of the growth on Route 9, where we were averaging a couple hundred thousand dollars a year, and obviously, John, that has come to a standstill. However, it's been able to be offset by the meals tax, and so it's not that...
A portion of it, but you overestimated what that meals tax was going to do for you, Jerry.
No,
and
we...
And you spent it all as it came in, since you adopted it.
Which was the point of it.
So the past board.
Yes.
Okay. So the one thing that we have been doing is addressing our OPEB issue, and, mm-hmm. and like Ms. Keegan says, it's something that's discretionary, and we haven't.
Yeah.
See, John, that's $250,000. $250,000.
So
that was put in this year versus the $100,000 that was put in last mm-hmm. year.
Right.
So I know when you make it sound like we're drunken sailors. These are things that we're trying to catch up on.
I want to address this further down the road.
Yes.
And I want everybody to realize what's happening here. We've been through it with the Finance Committee. We've been through it with the School Committee. We all are on the same page. We all see what's happening, and we're not doing anything about it. We're not cutting anything, or we're not moving forward to fund this.
We're playing catch up when we can.
I think we're actually doing a little bit better than we think, because as we pay for OPEB, we're resolving that liability. And then next year, our estimated OPEB contribution is?
It depends on what you want to do. At this point, if you fund the OPEB at 245 this year, you have turned the corner. You are now paying more into OPEB than you are paying out in retirement benefits. So that means you are now on the downslope. That downslope is a very long downslope, probably greater than 30 years at this point, at that level of funding. But it does mean that you have now gotten ahead of this liability. It's not going to grow on you based upon all things being equal, of course. You could decide that you could go for another $80,000 additional contribution to OPEB in order to get yourself on a track to pay down OPEB over a 20-year period, or you may decide to gradually increase your OPEB contribution in order to achieve certain targets in a longer time period. So you're in a position where you've done the big escape velocity kind of arithmetic progression over a 3-year period. You're now turned the corner, and now you have choices as to how you want to fund this going forward. You don't have to be as aggressive as we could have been, and you can redirect those dollars elsewhere.
So I think that's a positive thing. I understand, yes, we're falling a little behind other things, but...
Mm-hmm. But to that point, that's why I really like to look at OPEB separately, and I like to look at the state assessments separately as well, because they go up, they go down, their formulas, I mean...
Those move all the time. Yeah. The OPEB's being added every time someone retires, and we need to fund
And
you need to take that into consideration every single fiscal year.
Yeah, and so the point I want to... that's exactly feeding into a point I want to make, is that the reason I was saying, you know, or asking, you know, spike out those one-offs, if you will. Yes, OPEB's ongoing, but it behaves differently than all the other line items. How much are we building into the roll-forward budget? Because, and I'm going to say this out loud, and it's not going to be popular, but would I have 1 year left on my term? Okay. So it's not a re-election year. So, but we... what this is going to force us to do is to really take a serious look at some things that we have held sacrosanct. And that, I think we need to take a serious look at staffing, because the largest portion of our budget is people. I'm not advocating for any sort of, you know, layoffs or anything like that. I want to be crystal clear on that. But people are our biggest asset, but they're also the biggest cost here. And we need to make sure when we're going through all these departmental budgets that we have a really clear handle on what these positions are providing. And we may need to be shuffling some things around, because to your point, we have areas that we are deficient in. We don't have enough people, or, you know, perhaps the right skill sets to get some things done. And nobody wants to have those conversations,
exactly.
But we're at a point now where they have to be had. And they have to be had in this budget cycle. So I'm just laying that out there.
I brought them up a few times, you know, through regionalization, through combining departments, and it's never really gone anywhere. Nobody's really addressed it. None of us have.
No.
So Joyce just keeps saying another survey.
Well, she's not here.
I know, but without the facts, we can't make an honest decision here.
Yep. Okay, so do we want to make a decision about what we have before us now?
We kind of have to, don't we?
We kind of have to.
Yeah.
The only thing we don't have to do is put OPEB in. I mean, that's probably the only number we can play around with here.
But OPEB is being funded with free cash, and it's, a one-time clear expenditure, to David's point.
Yeah.
It's an investment in the future. I think it's a wise decision to fund OPEB
at
this level.
To move that money over to there
and
right now.
And it's one time, and... Again, one time.
That I do agree with, because it's over a $7 million issue, and it needs to be addressed.
I think John's right. We're all saying the same thing.
Just differently.
Yes. Okay, so...
I'm very interested in catching up and getting some of these buildings up and getting the equipment up to snuff and getting the old PEP funded.
Absolutely. And if we put it in front of the people and the people want it done, then that's when the tax rate's going to go up. For a period of time to make up for all the deficiencies that we've grown into here, you know?
Okay, so
what, do you want a motion?
Yes, please.
I make a motion to, what is this, Article 2?
Yes.
Yeah. What happened to Article 1?
We did that before.
We are, okay, sorry. Make a motion to approve Article 2 as presented.
Second.
Any more discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
I'm just
aye. I'm sorry.
You can say no if you want.
No.
We'll go longer. Okay. Four ayes?
No, I agree.
Okay.
Okay, that too.
We're making fun.
All right, we're getting punchy here. Let's concentrate. Lock down here, okay?
If you really want me to change my mind, I will.
Okay, Article 3, we took care of that already. That's the public
access cable.
Yeah. I could set up that. Okay. Article 4 is gone. Article 5 is capital stabilization.
Okay, so this is where we run into some of our budget issues, is that this originally was proposed to you as a $300,000 article. We don't have that kind of free cash. So $242,986 can be placed into the capital stabilization fund. It will fully fund all of those items in the capital recommended capital plan and leave a balance of about $10,000 for future use or emergency use.
Is it $242,986?
Yeah.
Where's that on here?
Should be.
Yep, got it. All right, yeah. Thank you.
Any other discussion? I think we kind of discussed it a little bit with the last article.
We did. And I hear John here as well, but again, I think that there's an awful lot of things that are being added that are been needed for a long time that are being taken care of here.
Okay, so is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No. Not at this time.
Okay.
David, the police locker room improvements.
Yep.
The capital planning didn't fund that.
We looked.
There's a question regarding that, right?
We Linda and I reviewed our notes on that one, and there were two items taken off by the capital planning committee. The first one was for upgrades to the North Hadley Village Hall for $12,000. And there was another issue. Let me. I have to go into my notes a little bit, but there was another issue that was not funded.
That was an exercise.
That's right,
$29,900.
Yeah, I'm going to have a question about that. Right. But the locker room improvements were recommended by the police department and capital stabilization, so far as my notes reflect, showed that they supported that.
Okay, I respectfully disagree, but okay. We can address that at our next meeting with capital stabilization.
All right.
And I haven't voted on this yet, so I'm going to vote with John no, so that's 2-2, and then I'm going to make a motion that we ask to take that locker room improvement out of there.
Are you voting on Article 5 or 6? Wait,
no, we're still on 6. It was 3-2, and I hadn't voted.
We just jumped on 6.
No, yeah, we haven't discussed 6 yet.
We just started 6.
The 242 was funding the capital stabilization account.
You just moved into 6.
Right down at the bottom there.
Okay. Okay, so Jerry started discussion on 6.
I'm sorry.
I will
vote yes.
Jerry?
I will vote yes on 5 and no on 6.
So Jerry, actually, we haven't had a motion yet on 6. So Jerry's saying the 10,000 shouldn't really be there.
Right.
So the other discussion item here is we have two trucks for DPW on here. So what's on the capital article numbers? For Article number 6 capital, we have a school bus, which we are going to put out for a borrowing. Two 550s for the highway department to take out a capital stabilization. International 7600 truck for highway, which is going to go for a borrowing. So these are all, the borrowings are debt exclusions,
mm-hmm.
If I say that, just so you know. The backhoe for the highway for $155,000. That's a borrowing. Then there's a pickup truck that come out of sewer reserves. There's clarifier rehabilitation out of the sewer impact fees. Primary or secondary?
We're all primary.
You're only primary? You don't have secondaries yet?
No.
That's right, you don't. Sorry.
That's just final.
All right.
You mean we don't?
We don't. We don't. Sorry.
Two final all right. Sorry. Clarifiers.
All right. Squirrel moment. All right. Light truck for water department. That's coming out of water reserves.
That plant's 27 years old right now.
Ours is about that age too.
With no major improvements.
Yeah.
Except for the aerators.
Okay, so telephone system, rifles, ballistic helmets and gear, radar units, locker room improvements, air packs, and a split air conditioner for the library are all coming out of capital stabilization. So this is what's being proposed to us. The total is $995,620. The question is, do we want to keep this set up? Do we want to take some things out? Do we want to move some things to borrowing as well? That's really what we need to decide.
Can I ask a couple of questions about specific line items?
Go ahead.
Okay. First question, since the chief is in the room and some of these articles are related to police, I'm obviously not on the Capitol Committee, but a question was posed that I didn't feel comfortable answering from citizen who wanted to know about the $8,000 of rifles. Are these new rifles? Are these adding to our arsenal, so to speak? Or are they replacement of?
The rifles that we have right now are Vietnam era rifles. Mm-hmm. Very old, that we got from what they call the 1033 program, which is essentially military surplus.
Mm-hmm.
What the rifle requests on the Capitol are brand new, updated rifles that we can actually train appropriately with.
And so
the ones that we have right now are actually extremely long rifles, and they're just not conducive to the types of training that we do with long guns.
Okay, and so can I safely indicate to people that the rifles, the ballistics, these are, in your mind, safety issues for your
Certainly,
force?
Yeah, especially the ballistic and the riot stuff. That's something that we don't even have.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that I had that right.
Yeah.
So the second question I had to do, and maybe it's best posed to Jerry on the committee, but my understanding is that there was a line item on there for I think it was labeled like the exercise room or something like that. But in conversation with Chief Spanknebel.
Yeah, that was what Mike requested, that one.
Yeah, and I gleaned from the conversation that it wasn't just an exercise room, that it actually had to do with a modification to the building to protect the computer equipment?
Yes. Yeah,
can you explain that a little bit more? Because I was kind of surprised it came off, if that was the case.
The room that we've identified a place to put our servers, which in speaking with our IT personnel, the way that it has been set up in at least the police side, the server that basically gathers all of the information that we utilize is in a spot that, according to him, shouldn't be. So we were talking about moving into the 911 room.
Mm-hmm.
The 911 room has dedicated air conditioning, but as we go along, it develops, it gathers more and more equipment as well. So the idea, when I believe Sergeant Shanley was actually in charge of the department at the time, had been speaking with the fire chief about a place that we could actually make dedicated solely for a server that could keep it all safe, secure, and meet all the regulations that we're supposed to meet. So they located an area within our unfinished exercise room that's in the building.
Mm-hmm.
That's something that we've been trying to finish for several years now, to make it an actual exercise room. We have cordoned off an area within that room to build another room that we can safely store and protect our server. So the reason I think he listed it as that was because I believe he wants to finish both at the same time, but the server area is vastly more important.
And is it possible to take care of the server issue, and if it was the desire of people who felt that the exercise equipment portion of that could be pushed off? I mean, could we deal?
Yeah, I don't want to speak for Mike, but I can tell you right now that as far as he and I have talked about is that server area, that needs to happen. That's
yeah.
very important. And he and I have spoken about not only the exercise part being pushed off, but also if there is any confusion about the locker room improvements, that is push-offable as well in order to get this server area completed.
So, yeah, I'm so glad you said that, because I was just going to ask, I would actually be in favor of bringing the server issue back on the table and asking your humble compliance to push off the locker room.
We need the server room. It's very important.
Okay.
So is there a number for the server room?
It's $29,000, I think.
$26,000 or $29,000.
But that included...
Yeah, the problem is that we'd have to talk with Mike, because I believe he did include...
The exercise.
The exercise portion of it, and I don't know what information he's, you know, using to get that number, so...
And if we could get that broke out.
We can talk to you about that.
The structure's all set in that room for what we're gonna do, Tim?
Yeah, I mean, it is coordinating it off, putting up some walls, getting some proper AC in there. It's right in the attic area. It's very hot up there, and it really shouldn't be there. I'd also like to comment, with regard to lockers, at some point, they really need to be done. These guys are sharing these tiny little lockers. Two guys, these small lockers, it's not good. At some point, we really have to address that.
We just can't do everything at once, yeah. And that's the thing. I mean, to me, the server, you get moisture, you get excessive heat, that's an accident waiting to happen.
Then you'll lose your server.
Yeah.
But just, all I'm saying is, we got to keep it on the limelight and get it done somehow at some point.
Ask for the recommendation of the Municipal Building Committee on that.
It hasn't been brought to our attention.
So do we have a number for
the server room was $29,900. I'm looking in here to see if we can borrow the money, if we can make that a borrow within the levy.
That would be a very
So the
only one time thing, so anyway.
If the locker room could get pushed off, you're looking at borrowing 19. And of that 19, I think from Chief Mason, that he's telling us that the 29 is not completely the server room information, that there is a portion of that.
Yeah. For the exercise equipment itself. And
so here's my recommendation. If it's the will of the board, you put the server room on listed here for $29,900. And you list it as a borrow article, and then next week we can refine this information, and then when we're presenting the motion to the town meeting, we can have a clearer sense of what we should be asking for.
So I'd like to make a motion to amend Article 6 to include the modifications to the server room
and
for public safety. Pardon?
And to?
For the amount of $29,900, and have it added as a borrowing article. Is that everything?
Second.
And to delete something?
Oh, and to remove the locker room improvement in the amount of $10,000 from capital stabilization for future consideration.
Does that second still hold for that?
It does.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Our IT's almost as ancient as our buildings. So.
We have IT.
What IT? Yeah.
Okay. So then, motion to. Oh. So and
you've amended
Article
it,
6.
Have we voted on it now?
We just did.
Okay.
Oh, well, yeah, we just, that was for the amendment. So do we want to vote for the whole number?
Oh, right. Yes.
As modified by the amendment.
Okay.
Yep.
There's a motion and a second to vote for the whole number. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
For the whole article.
I will abstain because of the highway vehicles.
Okay.
That are on there.
All the DPW stuff.
Right now at this
clarifier.
Time.
Clarifier.
Okay, so then there is separate parts to this motion which has to do with how we borrow the money, and we don't really need to vote on each individual part of that. We
no.
vote on the whole motion. So now we're up to, I lost seven. Seven is for the water, Route 9 water lines. This is from the Water Enterprise Fund. So $377,628. Oh, we did. Sorry. That's all set. Sorry.
Okay.
All right. So number eight. So number eight, we need to take up is. Actually, we've already voted on that one.
Nine.
We voted on nine. cruising along here.
Thank you.
11. 11 we did not take a position on. That's Holly. So do we wish to take a position on Holly tonight? Do we want to recommend accepting Holly?
Thought you needed to get your review in tomorrow first.
Don't we have to go a little bit further in the process before we can vote?
No, we've already voted on the other one. This is the recommended town meeting, whether we recommend yes or no.
But aren't they still, I mean, isn't there an important phone call to Barry Roberts tonight?
Yeah. There is. Yeah. I mean, we can postpone it until the meeting and vote up to our recommendation.
I feel more comfortable. It just seems like that's kind of a big...
Okay. Any other
technical little issue there?
All right, well, it's still there.
I'm ready to vote now.
It's still there, but we're going to... All right.
All right, so that's Holly Road, Laurel Drive. Did you take a vote on that?
We did it already, didn't we?
I don't think so.
No, neither one of them. I thought because you needed to view it tomorrow, you weren't going to vote on it.
We wanted to do that for the same reason? Wait until we do the viewing and all that?
I think so. I think it seems like the...
Okay. We can vote our position anytime between now and town meeting, too.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, I'm not...
There's no money involved in this.
There's no money involved in... And
you know,
let's observe the niceties.
Are you going to donate the dollar for Holly Road?
I tell you what.
Mr. Chairman?
I'll do
anybody
it.
Anybody got a buck?
I'll do it.
Willie's digging his pocket.
John, how can you allow such frivolous spending?
I'm getting a donation here. Relax.
You know, for the rifles, I think if the police chief broke out the rifles he has and had like a shooting contest and charged
Actually,
people like
no.
a couple bucks to shoot,
I did have another
probably
question about
money.
The rifles. I believe if you sold the old rifles off, you probably could pay for the new ones plus some.
It's illegal.
He has to give them back, actually.
Oh, yeah. Then there's that.
They don't belong.
It's illegal.
So here's
right
a
thought of it.
Oh well, it was a shop. Turkey shoot.
We disappeared, right?
Yeah, there you go. Have to give them back to who?
So, the state. I mean, the federal government.
Article.
They ask for them back. We have to give them back, whenever that is.
Article 15, the survey of Soterka Park.
Yep.
We don't have a figure for that. Is this article necessary? And I'm asking Andy as much as anybody else.
The survey is not necessary, but the appraisal is still necessary. The survey, as we found out, we did for the article for the Chapter 21B stuff.
So it has been surveyed then.
Yeah, Kathy picked it up the other day.
Right.
So
we would still need money for an appraisal.
So you can. There are two ways of evaluating land for sale. One of which is used to the assessed value, which we have. I don't know what that value is off the top of my head. Or you can go out for an appraisal. So
I think market value on that rather than the assessed value. We know that sometimes what's an assessed value of the town charging the town? I'm sure it's probably a suppressed value.
I think my assessed value of my house is quite accurate, unfortunately.
Yes.
This is municipal-owned property, of course, but is yours too?
So the appraisal will identify the highest, best use of the property and give a dollar value, and that typically is higher than the assessed value.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're in a situation of how do we fund this?
Well, we have $10,000 that we took out of capital because we're going to recommend that the server room be paid for.
Okay.
So if we do a true borrowing for the whole $29,000 for the server room, there is $10,000 that we could possibly take. Maybe it's probably going to be $1,500 for the...
$1,500.
All right, so this would be a transfer from capital stabilization.
Mm-hmm.
Is everybody okay with that?
Yeah, I'm okay with that.
How much is it for that?
$1,500 to $1,800.
So why don't we say $1,800?
Yeah, the high end.
You want $1,800 is the number?
Yes, please. How does Park and Rec feel? Does that work?
Yeah, it covers the cost of the appraisal, great.
Okay. All right, so now we need to take a position on this article?
To sell it?
No,
it's just the appraisal.
The money for the appraisal.
I make a motion we allow the money. Sounds ridiculously high to me, but if that's what it is, it is.
We'll put it on the high side just to make sure that we have it.
Actually, is it $1,700 on the high side?
No.
Could very well be.
Okay.
I'll second.
Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, now we're into our favorite discussion items.
Improving the buildings. That is important.
We voted on that last time. So municipal building.
You're supposed to get that information.
So
survey and which we have that anyways.
So municipal building committee, Russell School Stabilization. So Article 16 is to take the $100,000 in the Russell School Stabilization and to put it into an account to be used for Russell School projects. That's what this is for. Is that where we want to put the whole $100,000? Jump.
Well, I guess there's a larger story to it. I mean, we've looked at the per year request last week. We've looked at all the improvements that we recommend from now until spring, which was quite a bit less than the $200,000 that we've asked for. We've prioritized those and we've removed the ones where there may be an opportunity where they could be funded through CPA. Because after our meeting this week with CPA, I think we better understand what may be approved, what may not be approved. So I would like them to have the opportunity to say yay or nay on anything before it goes to vote.
We agree to that.
Right. So, the request now is for $66,000 for all the improvements. And I believe you proposed a change to this particular article that was made by the select board today.
Well, we do not have, we're short, if there's $66,000 and $50,000 is what's wanted for the building commission.
Right, and so just to
there is not.
Right, to clarify that just a little bit, we did the math a bit and listed all the projects that we perceive that the consultant would have over the course of the next few months, at least until the springtime. And in order to not delay some of our plans for the facilities, these are important studies that the architect and the plans that the architect needs to create. That full list equates to approximately $80,000. We have, I'm not sure exactly what's in that account, David, 40-something thousand.
Is the consultant account?
Yes.
Yeah, a little bit more than that.
Let's say 50,000. So that would remain, that would ask for 30,000 rather than 50,000 for the consultant. So we're at 66 plus 30.
Danny.
$96,000. We have the improvements itemized, but so that number is, I guess, quite similar number than as to the Russell School.
Other side.
So out of that number, out of that $96,000 you're asking for, how much of that actually is for Russell School?
None of it. At this time, I mean, other than the necessary modifications to the building to preserve it during the heating season.
The seismic.
Yeah. No, we do have the seismic.
Last week we voted that $7,750 for it.
So that's theoretically been removed from the $50,000 budget that we have from last year.
So that's why we're down to about 42.
Yeah, we're 42 then. Right.
So that was 1,600 already out of it, right? It wasn't 50,
you
were down
for the HVAC controls project. That's right.
So you're down about 10.
Yeah, we're down about
8.
The improvements we're recommending for this cycle do not include anything at Russell School because other than preserving it for the short term, we don't want to get into any projects until we figure out what we can do with it. And the seismic study is the first step. So
So how much do we know we need to do to preserve and secure the building? Because that's got to come out of this $100,000 too, right?
Well, we have an operating budget for that building based upon our prior history when we had to mothball it. I think we've got about $8,800 in operating expenses for that building.
We don't have to hear here to talk about that.
So
we go through that. Yeah, so there's annualized expenses for mothballing that building, plus some unplanned potential there. There's a broken pipe or something like that, but hopefully the system will be completely drained, and we'll try to minimize the risk.
Swapping out the heat detectors, or the smoke detectors for heat detectors is another item.
Another critical thing we have to do.
So if we take this $100,000 and we vote to put it into a capital account, or in an account to be used for buildings, and Russell School mothballing has to come out of it, any other type of any additional
Russell School mothballing, $8,800 is out of a different account. It's already been set aside.
That's
well,
part
we have, of the budget, right?
If we have anything over 88.
Okay.
8,800.
Okay. All right.
So we have 8,800
electricity going in there.
Yeah, that's the carrying cost of Russell.
So
8,800.
I will say that the projects, I mean, first of all, I appreciate the full conversation of the budget because it helps us understand your position as a committee. It's not just about us, and we recognize that. And just sitting in here listening is helpful to us to understand how we fall into the bigger picture. We do have a miscellaneous item for $25,000, which is
out of that 66.
Out of the 66, which is set aside for roof repairs. Other unanticipated happenings between now and spring.
Okay.
Which, you know, we have had roof repairs at Russell School, other places, so we think there's really probably some money necessary there, but it's just, you know, unassigned at this time.
So Mr. Nixon, if we vote this instead of going to a capital account for Russell School, we vote it into a account for
enterprise account?
No, we put it into an account for municipal building repairs and design. So that way the municipal building committee, with the approval of the select board, would be able to use it on any building and for any repair or for any kind of engineering. So that would free up $100,000 without affecting the budget.
Back to Gil, Mr. Morning's point too. Instead of talking about the 100, if 80 is what's appropriate and we leave 20 in over at Russell School, does that meet the needs of everybody here? Because then we have the 20 regarding any, as you talked about, emergency that can be dedicated over there. The 80 more than suffices with the needs that thus far you've been presenting to us. Does that work and still have make everybody happy?
Yeah, so right now the money is locked into an account that takes a two-thirds majority vote to get out and a penny of it.
Next comment is going to be, if we're going to do this once, let's do everything.
Exactly. And then we can enter into a gentleperson's agreement that 20 of it's going to be reserved for a particular use in a particular location.
Right. Well, they have to come.
They have to come back
to move
to
it anyway.
Right.
So. Do we need to change? So we would take Article 16 and change that to be an appropriation of the Russell School Stabilization Account into a capital building.
Municipal building general purpose account.
So we don't want to call it an account because then we're back to that two-thirds majority. So what we want to say is take that article, which currently reads, to see if the town will vote to transfer from the Russell School Stabilization Account $100,124, and that's the interest it's earned, to repair and renovate the Russell School building and associated facilities. We would change that last phrase to say, to repair, renovate municipal buildings and associated design costs.
Okay. So by doing that, that means that
18 will be out.
Yeah, Article 18 now goes away. Mm-hmm. And Article for the additional money for the consultant
would go away too until the annual town meeting.
So 18 to 66 would go away and the...
23 would go away.
With the hope of getting that, recapturing that money somehow later on.
Well, I would say that, you know, our committee has not entertained this as a committee and voted on it in any way, but I think we're here and forced to support any preservation towards buildings. But to be clear that we're not abandoning Russell School by doing this, by making these necessary repairs to other buildings. It's more of a prioritization, and our plan is to move fully forward on thinking about how we take care of that building, what we do with that building in the near future. And I think also importantly is that this money is still set aside for buildings uses, and the process by which we ask you for the money to do the improvements is fine, as long as it, you know, the money can't erode on other town uses and it's maintained as something for building uses only. That's in the spirit of what we discussed.
Were you okay with that?
Of course, there is concern that this is the reserve account, so to speak, for Russell School going forward, and we're basically depleting that. So we'll be looking, you know, there will be potential future expenditures for maintaining in the interim before we have the plan fully developed.
Okay.
Understood.
So,
actually, motion to support.
This is for 16.
I'll second the motion.
Any more discussion?
I would just like to say that, I mean, I've been with this committee for a while, and these guys work hard. I mean, I exclude myself. I would say that between Tim, David, Andy, and Gary, they put a lot of extra effort into finding sources of funding for these projects, and they work very hard at trying to make sure that, you know, it's aligned properly with your schedules and budgets as well. That they do not operate in a vacuum, and they, you know, I for one, as a citizen, appreciate what they've done in the past year and a half, 2 years.
Thank you. We appreciate it too, all of you.
We didn't leave you, Willie, or Dave out either.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? No? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, so that means 18 we took care of and 16. So we can delete that article.
Mm-hmm. 17's been deleted or 17. Folded in. A seismic study. Yeah.
17.
Okay. Yeah.
17 is 7750 is already funded with existing funds. So.
Okay. Yeah, but we were going to include
the other two buildings
stuff too, and the senior center to try to help the library with their decisions.
Well, try to help all of us with the decision.
Yeah, but the, you know, we're gonna look. We know we got short funds. We're gonna do as much as we can with as little as we have, mm-hmm. and we're gonna push this as fast as we can, because this winter to this springtime is the ball's starting to roll, and it's gonna roll quick with the library. We have some serious decisions to make with groups, and we have to figure out how and where they're going to go. So I think be ready and be prepared for us to be sitting back here in front of you before the springtime meeting with some big issues that we have to deal with. And it's major funding.
We expect
when does this
that?
Come to an end?
When we disband them.
Hire out of being selected.
Okay, so that means 19's off. 20 is also off. 21 is the land purchase. That's off.
That's off. We're unable to provide the necessary documents for CPA approval.
Okay.
And then so that means 22.
Development of property.
Is off. And then all we're back down to is number 24 of yours, which is to recollect $1,800 of funds and...
apparently not working from an updated list there, which we had talked about removing some of these articles, including that one, to defer that since it's not a significant amount of funds.
Okay.
We'll push that off the spreadsheet.
Mm-hmm. All right. So...
That's extra money sitting around waiting to go somewhere.
It is, but we have a few more projects that are currently under the same funding mechanism. If we go after that 1800, now we're going to have to turn around and go
second
after the other ones.
And it's not enough. Okay.
We figured it wasn't worth the effort until we were done.
So that's all yours. Mm-hmm. We're all done with you guys. So the rumor is, for those who are keeping track of what's going on in our neighboring communities, is they're going to have a two-night town meeting. So if we could have like a two-minute town meeting, that would really show. Okay, sorry. So
we went from 10 to
1.
To 1. And that works great.
You guys are awesome.
We're very efficient.
We agree. Thank you very much. Yeah. You can stay if you like. But is there anything else you'd like to say?
It's three nights this week of meetings, so I'm sorry. Second week in a row.
All right. Well, and thank you very much for all your time.
Thanks for your time.
And we'll see you on the 22nd. Okay, we have community preservation. We've already voted on that one.
Yep.
And planning board, we decided not to take a position on either one of their articles. Correct?
Correct. So I think you are now in a position to decide whether you want to sign the warrant.
So we're now down to like 14 articles?
I haven't been keeping track, but something
yeah.
Something a lot less than 30.
It's like 10 articles.
Pretty soon we'll only have to have an annual one again.
Pretty soon, that'd be nice.
They almost got there just before the recession, but...
Old business number two, we don't want them for North Hadley Village Hall.
Do you want to have them for North Hadley Village Hall?
Shouldn't they be here for that?
Actually, I was wondering if we want to kind of... read it and come back to the next meeting and talk about it more.
Okay, I'm fine with that.
Right. Yeah.
There's someone out in the hall who's waiting to discuss the North Hadley Hall issue right here.
Which ones? Okay, so before we go on, we need a motion to sign the warrant.
I'll make a motion to sign the warrant.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Congratulations, you have a warrant.
We gave birth to a warrant. I'm so proud. Okay. So, the last item we have before we go into executive session is to talk about North Hadley Hall. We have a draft RFP, and I was going to put off our discussion of the draft RFP until next meeting. But I understand we have someone in the office audience who'd like to talk about it.
Nope, just wanted to listen.
Oh, okay.
So, well, on the 14th then?
On the 14th.
Yes. That's our next meeting, right?
Yes. And okay. Now that the draft RFP is in our packet, mm-hmm. It actually is a public document. So if anybody wanted to ask for it,
do you want a copy?
I would love a copy.
They could see the draft. Then they could see the draft before we come out with our final.
Thank you.
If we had known you were here, you would have taken care of it.
Yeah, but I wish you knew.
That was an interesting discussion.
Oh, thanks.
How many pages?
It's actually quite a few. I kept losing my yeah. train of thought as I was going through
it.
Only
got it's half not very and, exciting.
No, it's actually, it was like being at work and I kept falling asleep. No one caught that one, did they? Okay, so that's what we'll do with that.
Any chance of getting it on Channel 5, Richard?
What?
Oh, it's a lot. I wouldn't.
Too much?
Oh, yeah.
It's too much.
Too much?
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what
to do. Oh, okay. All right, did you want to?
I'm going to give them my copy.
Oh. You don't want to? Any comments about the?
Not really.
Okay, well, okay, so is there any announcements tonight?
On the 24th of October, there's going to be a dedication of the time capsule over by the bell, and it's going to be done in between 10 and 12 o'clock. So everybody's welcome to attend that as well.
Okay.
Condolences.
You can do that.
I'm trying to find the Guilford.
What's the date on that again, Jared?
Oh.
24th.
24th.
Thank you.
Hang on 2 seconds here. Just wanted to make sure I have the correct information.
Go ahead.
Because I just didn't print it off with me. But the select board, you may have noticed that Joyce Chunkalo isn't with us tonight. So on behalf of all of us, we want to express our condolences to her family on the loss of her brother. She's traveled out to be with family during this difficult time. So again, sorry for Joyce, sorry for her loss, and our sincere condolences to everyone.
Okay. So we actually forgot something, because Mr. Wiskiewicz took something out of the consent calendar, so we need to talk about the pay request for Schultz. So we have pay requests number 13 and number 14.
Motion to approve.
Is there a second?
At the recommendation of Mr. Klimansky.
This is pump station 1 and 4?
Yes. Yeah. So it's for all the work that's been approved, that's been done there and been reviewed by the architect engineer for payment and comes with their recommendation.
Okay. Second? Is that what you're looking for?
Yep. Some,
yeah.
Sorry. Discussion?
No, I'm not looking at
it. We're still on track for final substantial completion at the end of November and final payment at the end of December.
I had conversations with Michael regarding weather and problems with that, and everything that needs to be done at this point is underground and not subjected to that, and the promises have been made to make sure that the landscaping gets done and approved as well before it's complete, so.
Okay.
Excellent.
We have a motion, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Okay. Is there any other announcements from the audience? Okay.
At this point, I'd like to make a motion to go into executive session under Mass General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 2A3, to discuss strategy in respect to collective bargaining.
Roll call vote. Devine?
Yes.
Morian?
Yes.
Luskiewicz?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
As Chair of the Hadley Select Board, I state that the Board has moved and seconded into an executive session, and I state that the discussion of this matter in open session would have an adverse effect on the town of Hadley. Good night, everybody.